Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening. We're here.
We're here. We are indeed.
We are, yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So, announcements.
The announcements. Isabel's in charge tonight.
He's just going to have to do as he's told.
Going to be chaos. Yeah.
Isn't it usually chaos?
I think so. It might be more chaos than usual. Well, we're now a good bit into September.
We are.
Yes.
Yes.
Which means the folk in Bucky will still be needing their cup of tea before have your cup of tea at any point in the meeting and remember to come back. Yeah, that includes Joan and Pat in Aberdeen. You can have your cup of tea as well because I know they get a bit jealous about the Bucky folk getting
well,
a special announcement.
So. Yeah, I think they do sometimes. Yeah. Okay.
Busy week?
Busy week. I think it will be a busy week.
The past week was busy enough with the food bank. 28 mm-hmm. parcels going out for 57, was it? Well, round about that number. Got the computer working at Bucky Hall at last.
So that's been good for you because it means that you don't have to sort of sacrifice an hour through the week.
Yeah, well, it's freed up about another hour and a half.
Yeah.
When I was coming home, I had to put all those sheets that I'd written out. I had to do all that in the computer and the laptop at home. But I can now do that during the day as we go in Bucky. So that's saving me a bit of time as well. So I was pleased about that. What else have we done?
We did sing and play on Monday.
We did that.
Because that was our first one back, wasn't
yes.
it? So that was really good. And they were a bit slow in coming with their requests. But we got there in the end, didn't
they
we?
They all came, boom.
Yes, all just kind of
flooding in at once.
Yeah. So yes. That was really good. And we've been able to catch up with one or two. And I think we've maybe added one or two new members mm-hmm. That some of our girls have said about people being on their own with children and other halves being away working, so they were feeling a bit lonely, so they're going to tune into us.
And I've had a bit of London work to do this week.
Had a bit of London work.
So trying to figure out how to do the recording and then get it sent off in the end. Wendy, I actually put it straight onto the end drive. And then I told Nikki. But it was the only way I could think of getting it to her without sending it in the post.
Yes. So tomorrow morning we'll live stream that again.
We will live stream
and,
tomorrow
it'll be
morning.
Good to connect with everybody. And then again, our food parcels on Tuesday.
Yes, yes. And are Joe and Doris here?
Yes.
Yes. I can't see who's here and who's not.
Yeah, Doris said a wee while ago that she was watching.
So I managed to catch up on the launch of Joe's new book. What did they call it? Or Shrift Vest or something. Anyway, I got right through it, got to the end of it this afternoon. So I've watched the hour introduction to it, and then I've read through that book. So it fits in very well with what we're going to be speaking about tonight, even though it's Isabel who's in charge tonight. So we've got the food bank on Tuesday again.
We certainly do, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And then next Sunday.
Right.
We will live stream again.
Indeed.
I don't know if you want to say a bit about what you've done this week and looking into things.
Yeah, we did take some time to look through Salvation Army forms and the information that they were giving us as far as moving forward with our worship, whether we continue to live stream or whether we go back to a meeting together in the hall. And having read through what I have done, I'm very much convinced that we should still be continuing to worship as we are for the time being. That has kind of been reinforced to me with the statistics that are coming out from the Scottish Government in the past few days as well. We're up to 244 new cases today. Of the illness. So I don't think this would be, for me, the most sensible time to be going back to gathered worship. So we will continue to worship in this way, and we will continue to monitor whether we think that this is actually one of the ways that we will continue to worship longer term. There are a number of people who said that it's very helpful, and particularly in the evening slot, 6 o'clock seems to be quite popular.
Okay.
So we will continue to monitor the situation. We will continue to have contact with our divisional leaders and talk things through as well with
John
them.
Says, hurry.
I take it that was that we'll continue to do the 6 o'clock for the time being.
I think so. And it's been really good for us to connect with so many different people and people from that we've known, previous appointments and friends, and people in our present two appointments. So thank you for encouraging us and supporting us, and we will continue, as Bruce says, in this way.
Yes.
So our worship this evening. Well, we're in to September.
We are indeed, and the fields are very busy.
So we thought maybe that we should start thinking about harvest. And I know normally by now we would have had a harvest supper, but obviously we can't. You can have your own harvest supper at home if you want. So we are going to have, think about harvest this evening.
Good.
Okay.
And probably for the next couple of weeks as well.
I would think so.
Yes. Song number 70 in the songbook. We plough the fields and scatter the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. He sends the snow in winter, the warmth to swell the grain, the breezes and the sunshine, the soft, refreshing rain. Sing up at home.
Okay.
We plough the fields and scatter the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. He sends the snow in winter, the warmth to swell the grain, the breezes and the sunshine, the soft refreshing rain. All good gifts around us are sent from heaven above.
And we do have so much to thank God for, because he indeed has provided so much for us in our everyday lives. Psalm 103 says, praise the Lord, O my soul, all my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbour his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to his our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it, and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. Praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, who obey his word. Praise the Lord, all his heavenly hosts, you his servants who do his will. Praise the Lord, all his works, everywhere in his dominion. Praise the Lord, O my soul.
Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, as we come and bow before you this evening, we are very much aware of your provision for us, even in these very, very strange times that we find ourselves living in. We know that you are there and that you have provided all that we need. Lord, we thank you that in these past months, there have been so many examples of people going out of their way to help others, to help those who've been shielding, those who have had to keep themselves locked away from the many things that they normally do and the people that they would normally go about and meet. And also who've been unable to go out and see to the basic necessities of their own lives, such as shopping. Lord, we thank you because there are people who have stepped into that gap and have showed your love in a very real way. As we come to this time of harvest, Lord, we recognise that there has been much preparation for this, something that's gone on long before, something that happened in faith, believing that there would be a harvest. And Lord, that comes to fruition. And the people are fed through much hard work, through much waiting. Lord, we thank you, because as we gather like this evening, in this time which has included a great deal of waiting, we know that there will be a harvest for your kingdom, that people will be drawn near to you, that your love will be shared and shown, and that your love will make a difference in this world. So, Lord, as we gather here this evening, wherever we may be, we gather together in love. And we pray, Lord, that your name be lifted up. And we pray, Lord, that your name be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Happy anniversary to John and Lena and Yonda. 23 years ago. My goodness, John, you must be on track for a medal by now. I'm just looking across the road to see if Ruth's at the window looking over as well. Song number 71. Number 71 in the songbook. We praise thee, Lord, with heart and voice. Well, with first fruits we come, we bring thank offerings and rejoice and shout the harvest home.
I think it should be okay.
We praise thee, Lord, with heart and voice, while with first fruits we come. We bring thank offerings and rejoice and shout the harvest. Truth so holy. only first grave will be, and short the harvest home. Faithful with tears my life receives, taking my goodness home. Reapers return with golden cheers, and short the harvest home.
I know in the old songbook it had it as four verses.
It did, didn't it?
It did. But you see, and then
the chorus.
When you go to look for harvest songs in the songbook, you can't find them.
They're all scattered.
Because they've cut half of them out. And some of them that would have fitted in this evening are not in the songbook. We could have sung them, I suppose.
We could have.
We could have. But then those with the new songbook at home might not have been able to join in. So, I don't know about you over these past few months. What are the things that you have been getting up to?
Leading question.
Well, for us, we've had to try to find different ways of communicating, didn't we, with the congregation, and a bit of creativity.
Indeed.
So, what are the things that the new kind of things that you've been trying?
That's been the biggest thing. That, you know, I still go back to that first Sunday and I'm thinking, what have I done? I've sent out all these invitations to people to come and join with us online, and I don't know if when I press that button on the screen there, it's actually going to work. And since then, it's been trying to add a little bit and a little bit more to what I'm able to do. So things like still holding up my phone or whatever with pictures or videos to try and get a little bit more.
Well, I know that there was one Monday where you actually had to go to the hall because you were doing your teaching stuff. And I was left here on my own to do sing and play.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, oh, help. How do I do this? But it worked. It did. It worked.
Well, that's one of the funniest things is the two of us doing those songs for the youngsters, and then learning from them actually that they could cast that onto the screens, that the mums were putting it on the screen on the TV for children. I didn't realise we could do that.
Yeah,
so that's something that we're doing ourselves.
If you've got a fire stick, you can actually put this on, and if you've got a big screen, imagine the two of us on your big screen. What more could you want?
Still got the off button.
Yeah, I suppose you could turn it off, couldn't you?
But yeah, I mean, the whole, there's been a big journey in terms of technology for me. And we'll probably try a few more things. You know, I may well have a Sunday where I try to do this with a laptop.
Okay.
So the sound quality might not be as good that Sunday, or it might be better. I don't know.
It's just trying new things and different things.
As you saw when we tried streaming from the hall, recording from the halls, one thing worked and one thing didn't. So it's all a case of almost trial and error with that.
Yeah, so we say thank you very, very much for putting up with us and all the things that that we try to do, new things that we try. Because, I mean, if we had been worshipping in the hall, there might well have been some new things that we might have tried.
Indeed.
But we're not echoes at all, are we?
We're not. But that's been a big learning curve for me. Yeah.
Yeah. I have taken up the baking again.
You have?
Yeah. And last week, I had a go at making jam.
Yes. The harvest has come in the garden.
Now, I don't know about your gardens, if there's good things grow in your garden. There's nothing much grows in ours, but we have an abundance of brambles.
Yes.
And because we had been away, when we came back, there was just a whole load that were just ready. I think the first lot we had about £3. So I made some jam. I had a go. I looked up on the internet and tried it. I thought, well, if I don't try it. And so much so that I think I could try it with other fruits as well. I think it would work. So I bought a huge bag of sugar, so here's hope we'll have more brambles. So I've done two lots of jam, so and I've been experimenting with new recipes, and the folks that help at the food bank, they're still alive, so my baking can't be that bad.
Yeah. And I've been doing painting as well. Had a chance to do a couple of things on that, and I managed to get a little bit more done of the painting I'd started in Orkney. So Linda, it's getting nearer. It's getting nearer. I just have to then figure out how I get it down to Glasgow.
Yeah.
Or Bellshill.
Bellshill. Yeah. And well, I've kind of, the cross stitch has kind of gotten a bit of the go by because I've been busy knitting, and Seth has been the recipient of jumpers, and I'm in the middle of doing an Aran. I haven't done an Aran jumper for years, so you know, I think it'll be okay. It's a bit tricky. I did a jumper for him, which I did finish, and I thought, oh, why did I start this? This is really tricky. I don't know that I'm going to be able to do it, but I did.
Yeah.
So it's learning new things.
I think the other thing was the communication with our family, and out the other night. And I just stopped and said to Isabel, this is the stuff of tomorrow's world. Those of you who remember that in the UK, a programme called Tomorrow's World, where we were able to have, this was a video call while we were on the move, walking around the village with Ola Cameron and Seth, wasn't it? And I just thought, that's just mind-blowing to this old man.
We did it with Erland one night.
We did.
Right around the village. Where I was able just to show him all, but I mean, he had been here before, and I said, I'll take you to the beach. We're just coming to the beach, and we had a walk along the beach, just to be able to share something of God's creativity with us.
But that's possible because they've got a new mast.
Yeah, when we came here first,
telephone signal was awful.
It was terrible. So we bought a booster, and now we don't need the booster because they've given us a new mast. But I don't know about you. What are the things that you have tried, new things that you have tried during this lockdown time? I know right at the start, flour down here, I don't know what it was like anywhere else, but flour here was like gold dust. And it was a case of much rejoicing.
So scarce, wasn't it?
Yeah. Much rejoicing the one night. I can't even remember what we'd gone into Tesco's for, because it tended only to go once a week. And there was pallets of flour. And I was so excited because I got a bag of plain flour. It's not quite so bad now. There are one or two things that maybe you struggle to get. I think maybe the panic buying has kind of stopped. But, you know, God has given us so many talents and so many things that we can do. And maybe if we do ever get back to some kind of normality, whatever that is going to be, that we would be able to use the gifts and the talents that God has given us for his kingdom. And as Bruce has said, over the next few weeks, we will be thinking about harvest things. And we're concentrating mainly on the parables that Jesus has taught in Matthew chapter 13. And we're going to be looking at part of that a little later on. So I encourage you, if you haven't tried something new, go and find something new. Give it a go. Maybe you'll discover a new talent that God has given you, and use it to enhance his kingdom. We are going to sing again, and it's song number 58. I know this is a great favourite at harvest time. Sowing in the morning, sowing seeds of kindness, sowing in the noontide and the dewy eaves, waiting for the harvest and the time of reaping, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves.
Sowing in the morning, sowing seeds of kindness, sowing in the noontide and the dewy eaves, waiting for the harvest and the time of reaping. Shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Sowing in the sunshine, sowing shadows, hearing neither cloud nor winter's chilling breeze. By and by the harvest and the labour ended, rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Go then, though with weeping, sowing for the master, though the Lord sustained our spirit of decrees. When the labor's over, he will bid us welcome. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves.
I'm having a wee laugh, Diane, at your comment. Your sister Deborah used to sing "Bringing in the Cheese." She was only about five. I think somebody used to sing "Bringing in the Sheeps."
Singing in the Sheeps.
Bringing in the Sheeps.
I wasn't singing that tonight.
Yes, we are missing the golden sheaves, and we are missing the celebration that we would have in our normal worship. But you know, God is so good and so faithful, and even when you know our lives seem to have stopped, the farmers seem to keep going. We noticed yesterday when we were out, didn't we? Farmers at work, combine going, you know, bringing in the crops. And it was a beautiful day yesterday. And I suppose they made...
make hay while the sun shines,
well, that's
they
what
say.
They say. So it was good to see that and to see the abundance there and to see God's goodness and his faithfulness. We're going to share together in our scripture reading for this evening.
Scripture readings taken from St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 13. And I'm going to read verses 1 to 9 and then verses 18 to 23. So that's Matthew's Gospel, chapter 13. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it, while all the people stood on the shore. He told them many things in parables, saying, "A farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places, where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly, because the soil was shallow, but when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 160 or 30 times what was sown. He who has ears, let him hear." And from verse 18. "Listen then to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. This is the seed sown along the path. The one who received the seed that fell on rocky places is the man who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since he has no root, he lasts only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, he quickly falls away. The one who received the seed that fell among the thorns is the man who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke it, making it unfruitful. But the one who received the seed that fell on good soil is the man who hears the word and understands it. He produces a crop yielding 160 or 30 times what was sown." Amen. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
We're going to turn again to song number 15. For for the fruits of his creation, thanks be to God. For these gifts to every nation, thanks be to God. For the ploughing, sowing, reaping, silent growth while we are sleeping, future needs in earth's safekeeping, thanks be to God.
For the fruits of his creation, thanks be to God.
To be able to see comments from people, we will look at them all later, of different things that you have been doing during this lockdown time. Now, the big jigsaw is finished.
It is indeed. But everything's on top of it.
Everything's on top of it. But remember a few weeks ago, we did the thing on, you know, all the pieces fitting together. Well, I thought when I was finishing it,
that was a picture. 1,500 pieces.
I thought when I eventually, because I finished the sky and I had all the trees and greenery to come back to, and I had a few bits left, and I thought, there's a piece missing because this isn't fitting. And every time I tried, and I counted the number of spaces and I had the right number of pieces, but there was a piece in wrong. And I kept it. So it's finished. And I was going to break it up. I thought, I'll leave it here for tonight. It maybe get broken up later. But it's finished and it's all there and it's complete. And we spoke about that the other week, didn't we? How we are all part of God's kingdom and how we all matter, how we all fit together. What one bit's missing, you know, if you've made a jigsaw and the piece is missing, you know, it's incomplete. And when we're all together, we're complete. So we're all together here this evening. We are complete together in God's love. And as I said earlier, you know, we were starting to think about, we would have been starting to think about harvest. We would have been organising harvest supper. It might have been a soup and sweet, you know, a few pans of soup and home bakery apple pie, which is yummy, especially if you get the crust bit, because it's like shortbread and it's just beautiful. And we would have maybe had that, or we might have had a pie and pea supper. I don't know, we might have had Stobies. We might have done, I'm not sure what we would have done this year, but we would have had that coming together and of sharing together and celebrating harvest. But unfortunately, we can't do that. But however, we can still thank God for his harvest, can't we? We can still thank him and praise him for his faithfulness to us. So Matthew chapter 13 is a chapter full of parables.
Yes, indeed.
There are two or three different parables there, all talking about, and Jesus tells you that this is what the kingdom of heaven is like, what the kingdom of God is like. And And he also tells what the meanings are for our lives. Jesus used the parables to communicate the truths concerning the kingdom of God. And, you know, the teaching that Jesus did, so it may have been that when he was telling this parable, that there may well have been a farmer out sowing seed. There may well have been a farmer hard at work, and Jesus was able to use the illustration. And so he's using it to communicate the kingdom of God. And so this evening, we are going to think about the parable of the sower, the very first parable that we read of. And Jesus told the parable, and then he gave what he was meaning when he was saying these words. So he tells the parable about a man, a farmer, faithfully sowing seeds in his field. And they would have meant something to those who were listening. And he used this illustration to help them to understand what he was saying about God's kingdom. So the farmer is sowing the seed, and Jesus tells about what happened to the seeds that this man is sowing. Some of the seeds fell on the path, and those birds came and pecked the seeds up. Now, I was just a moment ago, I was thinking about this, because I was thinking about the strawberries we found in our garden that didn't plant. Uh-huh. We definitely didn't plant strawberries.
Didn't plant all those brambles either.
No, we didn't. We didn't. The birds came and pecked them. But do you know, actually, sometimes the birds can carry the seeds and unknowingly perhaps mm-hmm. plant them, or perhaps the wind blows the seed. But anyway, the seeds that grow, that fell on the path, the birds came and ate them. Then we see Jesus tells that some of the seeds fell on rocky ground, and we are told that they were scorched by the sun and they withered. And then some fell among the thorns, and as the plants grew, they were choked out. And then most of the seed fell on the good soil and produced the crop. Various reasons why in the rocky places there was no root for the seeds. The thorns, there was probably more of them than there was of the plant that the farmer was sowing. But the seeds, they were faithfully sown by the farmer. Each landed somewhere different, and the outcome for each one was different. In verses 18 to 23, Jesus explains what the parable means. And in these verses, we can see how relevant that can be for us today. You know, not just for the people in Jesus' day, but that for each one of us too, there is an outcome. And Jesus explains what the meaning of these words are. And so we see that the birds came and took the seeds from the path. The path, the word was heard, but was not retained. The birds came and ate the seed. The message was not understood by the listener. Jesus is saying, you know, when he speaks words, sometimes, you know, people's lives are like those of the seeds who fell on the path. The message was not understood, and the devil comes and snatches what has been sown within people's hearts, unknowingly, perhaps because the word hasn't been retained. The seeds that fell on the rocky places, well, the words were believed, but did not stay in the hearts of people. The word is received with joy, but because there is no deep root, it only lasts for a short time. When trouble or persecution comes, he falls away. You know, sometimes there are people's lives who are rooted deeply in God's love. And, you know, it's very easy. It's very, very easy, you know, to say that we're standing firm, that there's no deep root. And when the storms come, that's the time that, you know, if we don't have that steadfast faith in Jesus, we fall away. And then we see how some of the seeds fell in the thorns, and how the thorns choked the seeds out. The word is heard, but it is not heeded. The word is heard, but, you know, when all the worries of life come, and they do come, I mean, this is a very worrying time that we're living in at the moment. When the worries of life come, then they overtake what God is sowing within our hearts. God's word is choked out. We forget, you know, that our faith is the thing that we need to rely on in times of trouble. And there are many people perhaps who walk away because they don't have that deep root, that deep faith in Jesus. And then we see the good soil. The word is heard, it's understood, and it is acted on. And a crop is produced, and the yield is great. Each one of us can be like the farmer sowing the seed. Through things that we do, through things that we say, we can help people to come into a knowledge of Jesus. We can tell others of the good news of Jesus, not always by preaching at them, but maybe sometimes by the things that we do, by coming alongside people, by helping them, by the way that we live our lives. Sometimes the way we live our lives can rub off on other people. And perhaps they see something in us. They perhaps want to be like us. And perhaps our lives are telling for Jesus. You know, we need to allow God's word, the seed, to make a huge difference in our lives. It's no point us reading God's word unless we are going to allow it to make a difference in our lives. We don't always profess to know everything that the Bible says. But day by day, God reveals more and more of his love to us as we live our lives day by day. And so we need to allow God's word to make a difference in our lives. We need to listen. We need to hear what God is saying. It's no point just listening and hearing, but we need to do something about it. And although our lives are very, very different at this time, we can still be faithful in spreading God's word where we go. As I said yesterday, watching those farmers faithfully going out, I was thinking, you know, the rest of the world's come to a standstill. But there's the farmer out. I know sometimes along the roads here, you know, if you're in a hurry and you get caught behind a tractor and you can see the farmer far enough sometimes. But, you know, they need to do their work. And if they didn't do their work, we wouldn't have food on our tables. We wouldn't have the bread that we have. We wouldn't have all the good things that we enjoy eating if it wasn't for the farmers. And so as I watched them faithfully yesterday, it reminded me about what I was going to speak about this evening. And I was reminded of the faithfulness of the farmer. And that reminded me of God's faithfulness to each one of us. You know, the world's in turmoil, but the seasons are faithfully sent to us. We sing the words, summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above. Join with creation in manifold witness to God's great faithfulness, mercy and love. I think that's the words. And we are reminded that God is faithful. Morning by morning, we see the new things that God has to teach us. You know, we've already spoken this evening about the different ways that we have been able to spread the seeds of God's word faithfully each week. And I just pray that as we have shared God's word with you, that you have been able to, again, learn something new of God's love for you. Even this afternoon as we were out walking, we were talking about if William Booth were here, I wonder if he would be saying to us, get back in the hall, or if he would be saying to us, get out there and do what you're doing. We just have to be faithful in what we do, in spreading God's word and allowing the seeds of God's word and God's love to be sown into the hearts of people. Yes, as we've thought about where the seeds have fallen, there will be times when the evil one will come and snatch that away. There will be times when, you know, the word isn't deep-rooted in people's lives. There will be times when other things will choke out God's word. But if we are faithful, maybe we will see the harvest of souls in the kingdom of God. I think every year at harvest time I say, as long as we are faithful in sowing the seed, we may never know of the seeds that we have sown in people's lives until a long time after. Bruce and I have, over the years, have heard of people who've come into a commitment to God, and it might have been seeds that we might have sown or seeds that you might have sown in their lives, but we just need to be faithful. And so at this harvest time, when we thank God for his goodness, let's remember to sow those seeds in the lives of the people that we meet day by day.
We're going to turn to our concluding song for this evening. There is a little bit extra after this as well tonight. This is a special Sunday for me and many people that we remember as well. So we're going to pop this song and then I'll tell you a little bit more about that. Song number 9 in the songbook. Number 9 in the songbook. Come ye thankful people, come, raise the song of harvest home, always safely gathered in, ere the winter storms begin.
Come ye thankful people, come, raise the song of harvest home, all is safely gathered in.
So Lord,
quickly come, bring thy final harvest home, gather thou thy people in, be from sorrow, be from sin, let forever purified, in thy garment to abide, come with
And across the years of our officership, there are things that do touch us in a very special way. And one of those things was being asked to take part and lead the remembrance service at Auchengeach. Auchengeach is near Moodysburn, just outside Glasgow. And there was a mining disaster happened there in 1959, September the 18th. So this coming week is the remembrance of that mining disaster. I put on the tie that I got from the committee there on this Sunday as a remembrance of that. That reminds me of the fact that the Salvation Army was involved in that had gone down to their work and never returned. 48 men went down and 47 did not return. The Salvation Army, of course, were called out as part of the backup to that, to support the families and the rescue workers in the coming days as they sought to try and bring a fire under control and then to bring the bodies out. But not only were the Salvation Army above ground, amongst the 47 who died was one William Skilling, and his son, Thomas Skilling, wrote this. On the 16th of September 1959, my daughter Carol was born, and my wife and I were very happy, not knowing, of course, what was about to happen 2 days later. I was at work on the 18th when I was called to the office and told to go home as there was an emergency. As I was about to find out, it was a disaster and that my father was involved. There were a number of men trapped underground. For 3 days and nights, the families of the men kept vigil, hoping and praying the men would be saved. But that was not to be. We were finally told the news that 47 men had died. My father was a member, did their best to give comfort and help all the families, and also provided food and drinks, which was a great help. Those 3 days were the darkest days of my life. I had 2 brothers and 2 sisters, and myself being the oldest. I had to hold myself together for my mother and the rest of the family. My father was only 53 when he died, and he was sadly missed by all of us, and still is. Those words written by Thomas Skilling, whose father, William Skilling, passed away in that disaster. It seems such a tragedy, such a waste, and almost a foreign thing to me, because I knew nothing of mining. And having gone through my family history now, I discover that we're not just involved in the jute industry for years upon years upon years, but also members of my family were involved in mining in Fife and in the Newcastle area, and in tin mining in Cornwall. And in amongst all of that, it becomes a little bit more close to me. But I had the privilege for 7 years of leading through the service and gradually realising that there were people there at that service remembering what they witnessed. The doctor was there with us, who was a young man at the time of the disaster, and faithfully he was still showing up all those years later. There were those whose families had been lost, and there were those who on that day who still bore the guilt and felt that somehow they should not be there and the person who swapped with them should be. In the mining industry, as well as with agriculture and with fishing, and with many other industries, there is always that element of risk and that element of danger. And so this evening, instead of lighting the candle, as we've been doing over the last number of weeks, during our prayer time, I'm going to be lighting the miner's lamp, which I'll place behind me.
And so we pray. God of forgiveness, we thank you that love abides in the depths of your heart, and that you will to forgive us through Jesus Christ. Knowing this to be so, we cry out to you, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of forgiveness, we thank you that you know our hearts and that you accept us as we are. We turn to you in the hope of forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of forgiveness, we thank you that your promise is sure and that there is forgiveness with you. We embrace you knowing that you have already embraced us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of forgiveness, create in us a pure heart that we might love more deeply all who are made in your image. As we have been embraced by you, we embrace the world of your creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of forgiveness, may love abide in our hearts as it abides in the depths of your heart. As we have been forgiven through Jesus Christ, may we celebrate this gift in the company of all your people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for joining with us again this evening. We pray that God will indeed bless you in these coming days.